something about that. And so they found something that a lot of people were doing at that time. There was some enterprising person was selling statues. Statues of military men during the First World War. And they put them up at the beginning of the bridge. We still have them. Does anybody know where? Has anybody seen them lately?
Yeah.
They used to be near where they always were.
Yes,
although set aside a little bit.
Yeah, but now they're sort of hidden in the bushes.
Yeah.
And if you make the mistake of looking at them very long, you're in trouble because you're in a wreck. I'm hoping to persuade the city, perhaps when they get the Bayfront fixed up, to put them back where they belong. But the Doughboy is interesting. It had to be the Navy that sponsored these statues, because the Navy guy is waving his hat. The soldier, I started to say Marine, the soldier has a hand grenade in his hand, and I'm thinking, okay, whatever. Next. This is back. You see, there's the Doughboy with this, the fixed bayonet, ready to go at him. Next. Okay. And there's the Navy boy. Now, I don't want to offend anybody in the Navy. I have respect for the Navy. This is the new position for this one. I'm hoping we get them back where we can see them at our leadership. We don't have to work on it. This is the causeways. The one thing that I don't remember is having two bridges at once. On your left is the third bridge, not the fourth that we have now, but that is the third bridge. As you see, it's higher than the original Memorial Causeway Bridge. I don't know which one of these bridges were in effect the day that I went sailing in my brother's little pram, and I wound up over there. And I thought, I guess I didn't even think about it. It looked like I could get underneath it, so I sailed up to the bridge. This is a Sunday afternoon, so they raised the bridge to let me go under it. And there I am watching all these people stopped on one side and all these people stopped on the other side waiting for my little trail to go under the bridge. And you know what? I am an evil person at heart, because I enjoy every minute of it. And I have paid for it many times since, sitting myself waiting for another boat to go under the bridge. But that was one of my happy experiences, of holding up all those tourists. I'm sure they had to be all tourists. I would have enjoyed it so much. Okay. I don't have a date. Oh, we're to Isle of the Saints. How do we get there? Okay. This is a picture of Isle of the Saints. The building in the foreground is the first high-rise built on the Isle of the Saints. I'm sure most of you know that Isle of the Saints was mangrove islands right over there. All mangrove islands. There's a picture coming up with that in it. But a man named Francis Skinner lived in Dundee, and they could buy the underground land at that point. And he and his company owned that, as well as most of the north end of Clearwater Beach. And so he got permission. My mother had the newspaper here at this time. It was in the 50s. And she and the people on the beach were very unhappy about ruining their view of all these pretty green islands and all this sort of thing and whatever else. And so they them together and talked about it and complained loudly. And Mr. Skinner said, take a look at where you are living, because Clearwater Beach, half of the north end of Clearwater Beach is pumped up land. My mother lived on Lantana Avenue, if you know where that is. It's what, two streets over. And he said, the land that you are living on was pumped up all those years ago. It didn't stop her complaining about them messing up the bay, but at least it made her pause for just a minute to decide. The time came with this new causeway, this garden memorial causeway, when the city was not keeping it up very well. And the Beach Association, which felt itself responsible and still does for everything that happens on Clearwater Beach, complained, and they said, this is the beautiful entrance to our worldwide popular Clearwater Beach, and you're not keeping it looking like a garden. The city looked the other way. And so Bill Curtis was the president of the Beach Association at that point. And so he put together an organization called, I've got to find it. I guess I didn't write it down. Anyway, he had this long fancy term and had gotten over $10,000 towards redoing all the beautification on the beach, on the causeway. And the city thought, well, you know, maybe we had better fix it up after all. So the city went to work and spent the money and made the causeway much prettier. Except that they accepted some money from the state to do it. And so at this point, all of the lovely local flowers and shrubs along the causeway disappeared and was replaced by foreign stuff. Orchids, well, maybe not orchids, but birds of paradise, things that you just didn't grow naturally on Clearwater Beach. And when the Beach Association complained about it, they said, oh, that's tourist decorating. We do, anytime the state pays for something like this, we have certain things we do, and none of them are locally grown, which of course made it far more expensive to have the shrub, the beautification. The Beach Association was so pleased with the city and the job they did fixing up the causeway, that when they had finished, we gave them a party out on the causeway. I can't find my picture of this huge table that ran quite a ways out there on the side of the causeway, where all the city workers that had worked on the beautification were entertained by the Beach Association.
And I have a question for you. On the upper right hand, is that what the path used to look like going out between Caladesi and Clearwater Beach?
Upper right.
Yes. That would be up at the top of it.
Yeah.
I don't know. That is not a very good photo. Yeah. This is only, what is white there is only the first half of Island Estates. The two to the left of it in the picture were later developed as part of Island Estates. And the tip of Island Estates is right there, and those two big ones up the end. And Mr. Skinner was so sure that the city was going to build another causeway and bridge from Stevenson's Creek,
Sunset Point Road.
One over at the docks.
Seminole Motel?
Yeah.
Or Sunset?
And he arranged from the last lot, you know, Island Way is the street that goes from the causeway straight to the end of the island. And for 25 years, that property was not allowed to be sold by Mr. Skinner's order, because he just knew the time would come when the city would build that causeway and wind it up in front of what used to be Mandalay Shores. It's now Regatta Beach Club, and it's been five different things in between.
80 Mandalay.
But he visualized it coming across the, you know, connecting on the north end of Island Estates, and then going on to his, he has a beautiful double lane road there called Kipling Plaza. The only street on Clearwater Beach with a big pathway down the middle of it, just divided street.
There's Regatta Beach in the picture.
Yeah, that's the white one in the background is Regatta Beach Club. And so you see the end of Clearwater Beach.
And then you can see Dunedin Pass. He was asking about Dunedin Pass.
Well, I think that's how they go.
Yeah, but then before it is where the pass used to go. It's all filled in now.
So we entered from, you know, the causeway. And just recently they have tried one more time to put it up there. But Island Estates, unless somebody wants to spend a lot of money, if you've seen that beautiful home at the end of Island Estates where they were going to do the bridge, you know it doesn't come cheaply. So
was that bridge going to come from Sunset Point over to Island Estates and then the beach, or was it going to come from Seminole Boat Dock?
It was going to come from the Seminole Dock.
Okay.
Attach it and come in the north end of Island Estates, and then come in at Kipling Plaza in front of the room.
Regatta Beach Club.
And he was going to have his wonderful, you know, nicely barricaded.
And was that thought of as a residence bridge? Because there's nothing up at that end of the island that's commercial. Was that going to be for residents only?
No, it wasn't coming in up there. It would be at the big hotel.
When they thought about the one coming to Kipling Plaza, mm-hmm. was that supposed to be for residents only or no?
Oh, heavens no.
No?
Oh, heavens no. It was going to pile all those people coming down from the north.
Yeah.
What was 880 Mandalay, which is now Regatta Beach, was that originally a hotel?
That was originally built. That's a whole other history story, which I love. When I came to Clearwater Beach in 42, that was the place. I could go anywhere on the beach. I was 14 and I could swim. So I was allowed to go anywhere on the beach I wanted to, as long as I remembered to behave myself. Except the ruins, they started building. After the war, they started building that big building, and they got two stories, and there were just two big pieces of nothing reaching into the air. There were no walls around it. It was a wall here, but not here. It was a wreck. And that was the one place on the island that Nice Carols didn't go. Mother didn't bother to explain why, so I cannot tell you why, but that was the limit. And when I finally went anyway, I was horrified at the graffiti. It was dreadful. However, do you know the story of Mandalay Shores?
That's another meeting sometime, maybe.
After the war, they wanted them to build. Well, zoning on North Beach by that time, was single-family residence. And here they had this big piece of property, and so they said, we will not tear down the ruins and rebuild there unless you let us build a big building. And so finally, the city said, do it. And so that's the reason, that's the only really big one north of Acacia Street. And these two men came and bought the property. And the government needed buildings so bad that the housing authority loaned them several million dollars to build the building. And so what they did was they took the money, paid part of the $1 million to build the building, and then left the country with the rest of it, and have not been heard of since that I know about. So for years it was a HUD-operated apartment building, and but it was there and it was attractive, and it's even more attractive now. But anyway, he never got his bridge. This is, you know, I know what this is. It's Clearwater Beach looking south from the north end. A long, as you see the Clearwater Point, you see the green spot down here? That's where the yacht club is now. And the section beyond that, there's two houses, one on the edge, one over here. But now there's houses all along there. That is private property. You do not go there in an automobile without the person on the gate saying it's all right. It's still private property. And that is not a public road. Those people maintain their own road in order to have their privacy. And we've had some famous people living up there. Echo drugstores was one of them. I can't think of any of them.
The author of Blondie.
Yeah.
Who was the author of Blondie?
But you see at this point, but now I want you especially to see these lines out into the Gulf. These are black lines, there's some up here and some on down the beach. And notice how narrow the beach is. The beach further down was actually, the water further down was actually pounding and approaching the property, the owned property. And I want to show you a little bit more of that. And so the city went in and they put, they call them groins. And they were cement posts with boards between them. And they held the sand so that we have what we have today. And they're still there, but they're under sand. And I have a picture taken of my birthday party when I was 16. And we're on the beach. And my 6-foot-tall friend is standing in front of the seawall. The seawall, which is about like this now. And that seawall comes to his shoulders. And that's how much sand has built up. It's been a while since I was 16, but nevertheless, that the sand has built up there in these years. Yes, sir.
And Debbie and I live on Kipling Plaza. We used to, in the 70s, walk down to Palm Pavilion, but we always had to go at low tide because if we didn't, it was waist-deep water to walk. People don't realize there's so much beach now. Little sand there was back before.
Even in 72, when we first came back, it was still bouncing off the seawall some of the time. So we have these little tacky-looking things to thank for giving us back our beach. On the South Beach, they used to put in big cements of circles of cements, big, huge circles of cements, and that gathered up the sand down there. So we have to be thankful for all these things they thought of to save that beach. This is Clearwater Beach. The white part of it, you see, this is South Beach here. They've only got two fingers. We have a third. And
But look at how much of the North Beach was sand, was pumped in sand at one time. So you just, my mother had a garbage can in her back, in her backyard, and she didn't like the looks of it. So she had to put in one of those buried ones, you know, where you just step on the top, it comes up, you drive, you don't see anything but the top. Well, that worked fine, except when it rained a little bit, and we always knew when it had rained a little too much, because we heard boom, and the garbage can was floating. One time it almost came out of its place, so we're not that far above the water up there on the North Beach. So. But this is, you see, the causeway is already in place. I'm not sure which one. And you see the mangrove islands that became island estates up above it. I just was horrified when I found out that, oh, and one more, I just got there. The first thing of, my boyfriend had an antique car, and the gear, the accelerator was on the gear, the
steering column.
Yeah, thank you, steering column. And he said, want to drive? And we were headed down there. It was a sand road that went down and around and came back. And he said, you want to drive? And I didn't have any sense. I said, yeah. And we were going poof, poof. And that was fine. All of a sudden, he reached over and just flipped it up. And we were barely down there. I must have been doing at least 15. And we were coming to the end, and I could just see us just flying off into the water. But the ridges in the sand were deep enough to where we got that little car just all by itself, went and headed back to the beach. I didn't drive his car anymore. I didn't think I could trust him.
So in here there's El Dorado, Mandalay, Bruce, and Lantana.
Yeah. That's about it.
It was there then.
Look at the end here. It's the South Beach where the bridge comes out. You know, we've got all that built up out there and the condos on it and everything. But when we were first here, you didn't go beyond this spot right up here where that beach sticks out. There was danger beyond that part. They had mud flats there, and oh my goodness, what wonderful shells were in them. But you weren't supposed to go out behind them. Then we had Sand Key. Sand Key belonged to a young man who didn't have any family at all. And he just thought it would be absolutely wonderful if the city would buy Sand Key. And he was going to sell it to him for a wonderful price. And, you know, and he would see it in good hands. Well, the city didn't see it that way. So they said, no, we are not going to buy Sand Key. The county wouldn't buy it. So he just kept it till he died. And his secretary was his inherited, his estate, who turned around and sold it to U.S. Steel Development Company. And first thing you know, the next thing you know, they were building all these huge condominiums. At that point in life, you said, what's a condominium? I remember that because that was the first thing I ever heard of people actually, you know, living together like that. Yeah.
I'm guessing that his name was Dan, was it? Because it was known as Dan's Island.
Oh, yeah.
Before Sand Key.
No, I don't remember it. I tried to find it.
I think
it,
his name was Wright.
Ed Wright.
Thank you. It was Ed Wright. And so now, the city didn't buy the land. It doesn't own the land, but it is a part of the city limits. I don't know who figured that out, but there it was. And there was no way to get to it. I know there wasn't, because a couple of us one evening decided to see. We knew you couldn't get there from here, so we went down to Indian Rocks Beach and tried to
see if there was a way to get to Sand Key. And it turns out there wasn't. And furthermore, you couldn't turn around and go back the way you came without getting stuck in sand. And so we went and knocked on the door of the nearest house, knowing that these fine upstanding people would certainly let us use their phone to call his daddy. It seems that this had happened a few times before, and he wasn't very polite to us. And it turned out my Dave's father was the chief of police in Clearwater, and that made it a little bit embarrassing for him. And so the result was that he couldn't date me for 3 weeks. And I don't remember what, my mother probably laughed. I don't remember being punished, but anyway, it was one way to find out when you get to Sand Key. So finally, they built the bridge, but they couldn't afford it, so it was a toll bridge. And they finally upgraded it where we had tokens. I tried to find my token, it's there somewhere in my house. And we had the tokens. And the people on Sand Key started, Sand Key had a lot of buildings halfway up when the recession came, remember the recession? And they just sat there, empty and unfinished for quite a while. And then they went ahead and just finished them, and there were those of us who were wondering if that was, you know, if you got a building that's been sitting out there several years unfinished, and, well, I like my little house on the door. But they do have some nice places there. And so they finally built the bridge. And one evening I went to a meeting over there, and the city people were there, and they said, "We need to tell you to be careful when you drive across the bridge. Our people were out there today, and they found out that one span has dropped 12 inches. So there I was in my big heavy Buick, needing to go back to Clearwater Beach. I've never held my breath all the way across a bridge before, but I did that night. And then they fixed it and put the lights under it, and it's so much more elegant. They put it up higher, there was no drawbridge. And they finally, the business people of Clearwater Beach, finally came up with a way to make it possible for the Sand Key Bridge not to be a toll bridge anymore. So, I haven't said anything. About the new bridge, because I can't remember, maybe some of you do, this elegant new bridge cost millions of dollars compared to that first 20,000 they spent. And they got it up, and a whole section of it dropped. Does anybody remember that? That hasn't been that long. And, you know, they were so proud of their new bridge, and they were those of us who liked the old stuff.
It's because they didn't follow the engineer's design.
Yeah.
That's what
they
happened.
They finally got it fixed up, and of course it doesn't have a drawbridge, and so we just get to zip back and forth across the causeway. And, no, not really. Getting rid of the drawbridge was a very small thing compared to the increase in traffic. So I could not do this without mentioning the unmentionable. So what happened was, doing away with the drawbridge did not immediately solve the traffic problem to and from Clearwater Beach, and I was surprised. However, I was going to include
the roundabout
in my talk tonight, But the library, which has been very helpful, I might say, in getting, helping me get this ready, gave me their folder on the roundabout. Their folder. These are news articles about the roundabout, mostly letters to the editor. I didn't read it all, but I never got, I read some of it, and I never found a single letter that said, what a wonderful thing the roundabout. I do know that when it first, when we first got the roundabout, am I standing in people's way? So, when we first had to deal with the roundabout, there was much, and I'm not mentioning the fountain, we're not going there. You do know we had a fountain in the middle of it that blew water in people's faces when they were driving around. It didn't cost but about $1 million, and it lasted 2 months, maybe 6 months, not very long. And isn't that sad?
And it was reclaimed water, which was worse.
Yeah. Oh my goodness. But the people who gather, the regulars at the Beachcomber Bar, came up with a song in tribute to the roundabout. And I don't sing very well, but I'm going to sing it for you. Three cars in the fountain. Each one seeks their a separate lane. Only one will be granted. Which one will see the mainland once again? I just loved it. And one person got it out, or maybe it was a group of people, put out the word that the city should be sued over the roundabout because it violated the laws against separation of church and state. Because any sensible person knew they needed to pray before they used the roundabout. So I would love to offer to share this with you all if you'd be very careful and not let one page get off this table, because this belongs in the library. Promised to take good care of it. So, but we did have the roundabout, and we did have the. We've always got something to smile about on the beach. It's a good thing we have a sense of humor to have survived it all. And I guess I was going to finish with the roundabout. I hope you all enjoyed Clearwater Beach as much as I did.
Follow-up questions? Is there time?
Yeah, one more note on the roundabout. I read in the paper when they took that fountain out, it cost $400,000 to take it out, too.
Oh, yeah.
Well, thank you all for coming. If you have more questions, Ann will be here for a few more minutes. But thank you for coming, and we'll see you next month.